Hi everyone. Now that we've talked about the periodic table and different atoms, let's put them together and make a few molecules. A molecule is the smallest piece of a material, the smallest particle, if you will, and it's formed from a group of atoms. And so here's some examples. You can just use the same element a couple times, like an oxygen gas. That's a molecule. You've got two oxygen atoms fused together. Or you can mix and match. Here's a hydrogen, two hydrogens with oxygen, make water. You can have blood sugar, glucose. You got three different elements here, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and they're in different numbers. Now these listings of elements and their numbers, that's called the chemical formula. And your book makes a distinction between molecules that have more than one type of element in it. So hydrogen, oxygen, or carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, those are called compounds. And if you have a molecule composed of a single type of atom, like oxygen gas, we can call that the elemental form of oxygen, or just call it oxygen, even though it's O2. And you usually don't call it a compound, because it consists of a single type of element. And then what's interesting here, and what makes the world interesting, is that the molecules that are made can be very different from the elements that make them up. So take a look at water. Water has hydrogen in it, and turns out that elemental hydrogen, H2, is very explosive. And to have a fire, you need oxygen, oxygen gas. So the components of water, hydrogen, oxygen, are quite explosive. They burn, and yet water doesn't burn at all. And here's another example. We got copper metal and this yellow brittle solid here called sulfur. And you take some more oxygen, and you can put those together to make a compound called copper sulfate. And so there was this artist in London who took a big solution, a big mixture of copper sulfate dissolved in water, and filled his apartment with it and let it sit for several weeks until these crystals formed on the walls and floor and ceiling. And then he drained the apartment, let it dry, and this lady's walking through the hallway of this apartment filled with these pretty crystals. Okay, next topic, physical changes versus chemical changes. After a physical change, the material that you have can change one or more of its properties, but it does not change into a new substance. So without changing into a new substance, or in other words, the chemical formula remains the same. Some examples here that you're familiar with is you can boil water, so change liquid water into a gas called steam. And that happens at a special temperature, the boiling point of 100 degrees Celsius. And the chemical formula for liquid water is H2O, as is the chemical formula for steam, H2O. All that happens during this process of boiling is that the little particles of water, the H2O molecules, they're stuck together and form a liquid below 100 degrees. But above 100 degrees, those molecules have so much motion, so much kinetic energy, that they bounce around and collide with all the nearby particles of water and separate and unstick and turn into individual H2O molecules that bounce around in the air. That's steam. Another example is to take ice and melt it, change it into liquid water. And that happens at the melting point of 0 degrees. And the chemical formula for ice is still H2O. It really is water, but it's so cold, the water molecules are slowed down, and now they're stuck tightly together and form that hard, cold, brittle solid that we know as ice. Let's contrast that with chemical changes. In a chemical change, a substance changes into a new material. And in this case, the chemical formula does change. So if you burn something, like if you burn sugar or blood sugar, that specific molecule, glucose, well, you can burn it and turn it into carbon dioxide and water. And yeah, you've actually changed one material into two, and the chemical formula has definitely changed. That's a chemical change. A physical change also happens, right? The sugar used to be crystals as solid, and now the carbon dioxide is a gas. And the water, well, if you're burning this in a flame, the water's going to come out as steam, which is also a gas. But we're going to let the chemical change be more important. Say, burning sugar in this case is a chemical change. And I know it's going to take some practice to determine whether a change is physical or chemical. And, you know, the more you do it, the more practice you get, the better you'll be at it. And as a beginning tip, it is true that most chemical and physical changes can be reversed, but the physical ones, the physical changes are easier, right? So if you melt some ice, turn it into liquid water, you can reverse the process by cooling back down and freezing the liquid water back in the ice. That's pretty easy. Whereas if you take carbon dioxide and water, for people, it's kind of hard to turn it back into sugar, glucose. On the other hand, plants can do it by the process of photosynthesis. Okay, last topic. Let's talk about names of compounds. And it turns out there's a lot of rules. So if you want to learn more precisely on how to name compounds, take a chemistry class. But here we're just going to follow a few guidelines. And so there'll be plenty of exceptions, but we'll try and avoid those for the most part. The first guideline or trend is that most chemical names have the following format. And the compounds we're going to look at, we're going to limit it to compounds containing two different elements. So what you do is you find the two elements on the periodic table, and the element that is more to the left on the periodic table, list that name first, put in a space, and then the other element that's on the right, more on the right side of the periodic table, you want to take part of the name. And you'll get some practice and decide later how to break up the element name into a part or a root, but you only want to take part of the name. And then to the ending of this part of the name of the element, we add ide, I-D-E. And for many compounds, that will make the name. So here's some examples. Table salt has a chemical formula NaCl. So Na is over here, that's sodium. So first element, sodium. Cl, that's over here, that's chlorine. And then what we're going to do is just grab the chlor, that's the root. And then fashion the name, you got the element name, sodium. Take the chlor, there's a chlor, and add ide, sodium chloride. Another example here, we got K2S. K is potassium, S is sulfur, and we're going to take the root sulf. Again, just from practice, we'll be able to figure out how the roots are formed. And you put them together, potassium, and then sulfide, sulfide. Last example here is Al2O3. Al is aluminum. O, well, that's oxygen. So the element to the left is aluminum. Oxygen's more to the right. And the root of oxygen is just ox. And so the name of Al2O3 is aluminum oxide, aluminum oxide. Notice that in some of these compounds that have suffixes, the 2 and the 3, they don't show up in the name. Here's the second guideline. Sometimes you need to account for that 2 or the 3 suffix. That'll happen when nature allows more than one compound forming from a pair of elements. And then when that happens, well, if you have different compounds, you need different names, but they're going to have the same elements in it. So to make the names different, we're going to use a prefix in order to indicate how many atoms of each element we have present. And here are the most common ones. If you have one element, it's mono. If you have two atoms of that element, it's di. Three is tri, like a tricycle. Four is tetra, like that old game Tetris that had blocks of four squares connected together. A pentagon has five sides. Yeah, so penta is a prefix for five. And then all these silly little rules. Turns out that in chemistry, the first element, the element listed to the left, if it exists by itself, we should be using the mono prefix, but turns out we don't. Okay, let's just practice with a couple of them here. We got CO2, and if we follow the original format, element name on the left, space, root, followed by ide, then this name should be just carbon oxide. But it turns out nature allows a different compound to form from these two elements. There's another compound with C and O, just one element of each, one atom of each. Okay, it turns out that this compound we exhale and plants take in, this compound is toxic. They're different. So we need different names. So that's when you use the prefixes up here. So carbon is the element more on the left. Here's carbon, here's oxygen. Carbon's more on the left. So first name is carbon. The root of oxygen is ox. Add the ide, just like before. But now, we're going to say that because there's two oxygens, we're going to use the prefix di, dioxide. Carbon, yeah, there's just one carbon, but I'm not going to use mono for the first element. Oxygen, there's just one. So now we use the mono to make a different name. Carbon monoxide. You could also say carbon monoxide, but then the two O's would be side by side. It looks a little funny. Last example, two nitrogens, three oxygens. That compound's going to be called dinitrogen because there's two nitrogens. And then we got ox for oxygen, oxide, add the three, trioxide. Okay, when do we use the prefixes and when do we not? We'll talk more about that in later chapters. Okay, finally, the last idea you need to know about naming. There are some compounds that just have some common names, and we don't follow the regular format. So yeah, here's the molecule H2O, there's hydrogen and oxygen. Yeah, you don't even look at the element names to get a name of the compound. That's water. You should also be aware that NH3 is called ammonia, and CH4 is called methane. And as we encounter more compounds that have common names, we'll list those, and we'll just have to commit them to memory. Okay, that's all for now. See you in class.